the details. So here's the abstract from the paper, defining that we are, of course, in the middle of a cloud computing paradigm shift, and it's reflecting also on the enterprise software side, where most of the software is now being purchased or acquired through a service instead of developing your own enterprise software or deploying it through your own hands. Now, the paradigm shift has been mostly focused on the, let's say, the supportive information systems, which have been transforming to software as a service model solutions, but still the ERPs play a mission critical role, especially with large companies, and they are being still operated in more conventional operating models, such as deploying them on premises and operating it and developing it there through your own resources or through outsourced resources directly. Now, especially SAP ERP systems are very common for large enterprises, and they are being used in their mission critical services, and their adoption to a public cloud place, cloud ERP or software as a service ERP, has been really slow on the market, and the on-premise ERPs with SAP and with the large companies using it is still a very thriving business. And we can see that there has been little adoption efforts there. Now, this research was based on a multi-case study, which included interviewing 6 large enterprises, and the results identified 4 factors, which we can say that are affecting the cloud adoption for these mission-critical systems. And the findings, of course, indicate that the 4 factors being service quality and costs, these are the most significant ones. And also there were technical limitations and cloud characteristics or benefits, which were also identified as having a key factor role here. Now to form the basis of the empirical research, systematic literature review was conducted. It was done mostly in the academic databases such as ACM Digital Library and IEEE Explore, but also Google Scholar search engine was used to find relevant articles. And the search terms were being used were related to cloud computing, cloud ERP, and SaaS ERP, and all of the relevant papers and articles that were found from the databases were reviewed rigorously in order to improve the quality of the research. And I constructed a small framework here reflecting on the side that how the on-premise ERP implementation and the SaaS one, the cloud ERP, differs from each other, so that the previous literature is suggesting that there are differences in the amount of initial investment required, how much there are possibilities for the customizing in the systems, how the licenses are being purchased or owned, and how autonomous you are in developing the system, and overall how the system life cycle is affected in terms of upgrades and improvements. And of course, reaching through all this procedure is the security, which is a little bit different between on-premise and the cloud-based version. Now, here's an overview of the research itself. So as noted, this was a multiple case study, a qualitative research. I was using semi-structured interviews with the 6 persons. Each were representing different companies, all were large-sized. You can see them, the summary table here on the right side, and you can note that they have a long experience in the industry itself, and also a good amount of experience in cloud ERP systems and so forth. three of the companies were large manufacturing companies, two were public sector companies, and the final one was a consulting or implementation partner who was helping these same similar sized companies and global large companies implementing their ERPs. So, and all of the participants were randomly selected, and the criteria for selecting the interviewees was just that I was requiring practical experience from migrating or transferring these on-premise SAP systems to SaaS-based cloud, so that they would have some actual insight to the process and how it differs, and especially on the large enterprises perspective there. And the research question here was that which factors are affecting large enterprises SaaS adoption for mission critical systems. And here's the summary of the results. So as noted, these four factors were seen as being affecting the adoption, and these are of course related to how the large enterprises especially view that their requirements are, what they are looking after and expecting from the cloud, and what is potentially limiting their adoption capabilities and their interests in cloud ERP. And I'll go through this in a little more detail in the next slide or so. And again, here the four factors are. So system service quality was the first one and probably the most significant one identified here. It's consisting of components such as system availability, because when you talk about the requirements for system availability on mission-critical ERPs, and these are the systems that the large enterprises are running their daily processes, like their sales systems or their warehousing, how they are moving stocks from warehouses to supplying them through there or running all of these core systems, they are requiring very high system availability and SLA levels that are guaranteeing that they don't have any interruptions there, because they are of course directly reflecting on the financial side of their business there. And what was noted here is that the participants or the interviewees were quite happy with the on-premise setup that they were having. They had very strong SLAs and very good availability on the systems experienced, but on the cloud side from SAP's cloud ERP for the functions that they were using, it was noted that the SLAs were much more weaker, and the service guarantee was not enough for their core systems, but also the experienced availability from the functions that they were using from the cloud was much lower than on the on-premise side, that they had experienced service interruptions or unplanned downtime many, many more times than with the previous on-premise version. And like I said, the SLAs were not up to the requirements there, and they found it that it's hard to have this kind of a trust on the system side if your SLAs are too weak and the system is not available as much as you want. Now, also what was noted was that the support from SAP to the cloud ERP service was not seen as fully transparent, that they were seeing that it was opaque in terms that they are not aware of when SAP was doing certain things, and if they were able to commit to these certain, if they were like experiencing failures or something like that, then it was really hard to see that how they were being handled by the support there. And also the personality of support was seen as an issue, because when they were having their on-premise systems, they know who to call, who is responsible for each area, and where they can get their support fast enough when they have some kind of a urgent need for support. But with the cloud ERP operated by SAP, it was more that they were required to open incidents and just they felt that it was just wait and hope for the best that SAP is able to resolve the situations, whereas in the on-premise model they felt that this was more like personal and more urgent and more affecting the service quality there itself. Now, as for the cost side, the previous literature was suggesting that there should be cost improvements, or you would be able to save costs there. But in this study, it was not found as to be the case, because the companies present were noting that their current operational models, even with the help of external partners, was seen as more cost beneficent than through the cloud ERP pricing model. So first of all, the implementation effort, although it had been noted also in the previous literature that it should be a little easier or have some cost benefits there. And yes, they noted that you don't need to commit to anything before, you don't need to buy any servers or something like that, but because the overall operational costs on a monthly basis were seen as much more higher than with the on-premise system, the total cost of ownership was therefore seen as to be more expensive eventually in the cloud side than what you are having in the on-prem world. So therefore the costs were also seen as a factor that you would be increasing it, not decreasing as probably was the expectation from the cloud side. Now, as for the technical limitations, there were certain notable areas there. Network latency was one thing noted, especially with these large companies. And typically what they were saying is that you have certain mission-critical systems which need to be able to communicate through a defined and strict network latency requirement. These were saying that integrations to legacy systems or certain things like factory automation lines, they need to have like sub 100 millisecond response times or sub 50 millisecond response time, so that the automation lines which are connected to the ERP controlling them are able to fulfill their tasks. And if this was located in the cloud, the ERP, and it was too far from some of the geographical locations of the warehouses or the automated factory lines or so forth, then the network latency was growing too large and they were not able to utilize those functions even because the technical limitation was there. But also the cloud ERP customizing was, as noted in the literature, that it's more limited. Well, you are running a public cloud SaaS solution, so of course you have stricter customizing capabilities, and it's more of a like defined by the service provider that how can you customize, and it's not always the way that the companies were expecting to run their processes. Also similarly was flexibility seen, that the overall service is more inflexible, and sometimes it's a good thing if you follow the best practices, but the companies also felt that if they have already some kind of a process that they see that this is the best way that they are operating it, and it's like the one that they are using to generate revenue or have a competitive edge there, it's not something that they want to even change, as would be forced by the cloud service. And also information security was seen here more as a technical limitation. And although the previous literature was saying that security is some point that might be affecting the adoption eagerness for companies, but what was concluded here is that all the participating companies were not seeing this as something that would prevent it. They were seeing it as only as part of it, that you need to consider the security side, you need to have the technical setup there done, but it's definitely not preventing it. And then the cloud characteristics. This is an interesting thing, since this is also something that might be mediating some of the other factors, like that if you are very keen to have the cloud characteristics of the service, then it might not make a difference if it costs more or if the service quality is a little bit lower, if you have a strategy that you want to have these. But on the same side, it was also noted that some of these were seen as preventions for adapting a cloud service for ERPs. Like the frequent upgrade is a good example, because if the upgrades are forced like 4 times per year to a system, it was meaning that the users have to test all their integrations to legacy systems, test all their own extensions and so forth, and it was seen as causing a lot more work to maintain the system, even though the technical maintenance was now done by the cloud provider. And mostly these next points, that the ease of use is coming from the also that they are seeing that they are features that the customers want and are interesting ones, but also they are a bit related to the deployment of the new innovations through upgrades. And ubiquitous access was also seen here as a cloud feature that was either good or something that is not that much of interest for the end customers. And mobile applications, that's part of the development efforts there that you will get when you move to the cloud, that those are always present and with this SAP service. But that was for the conclusions, and as for the final parts of this presentation, that I would say that the research is contributing to this, our IS field here, that we help, it helps to understand which factors are affecting this cloud ERP adoption, so that it can be used through theoretical means or even in practical terms to understand from industrial side that how this can be seen from in the future. And it also highlights these requirements that the large companies have when you compare them with SMEs, because SMEs have been adopting cloud ERP for substantially longer time, and they have been more eager to move to the cloud and do software as a service model. But large companies have different requirements, and they are making more efforts here, and it can be seen that it's more of a struggle for them. And as noted, there has to be some limitations here, and for this study it's that it was only focused in one cloud ERP vendor, SAP, and all of the companies here are also from one country. Everybody is from Finland, although they were operating on a global model, most of them, and doing international business. And finally, further research could be done here on different cloud vendors and evaluating how they are answering these, like Oracle ERP, Cloud ERP, or any other of the larger providers, and if they have similar ones, or even from a different geographical point of view, if there would be exist some other kind of factors there, but or if the same ones are present. But that's actually for all of my presentation.